medicine in general, an evolutionary point of view has not been taken into account for, has not been taken into account for trying to develop new treatments for pathologies, although that, and this is what I'm trying to explain, is that it might be beneficial if you want to develop new concepts for treatments, for example, related to phantom percepts. So the two key points that I remembered from Professor Morassi's introduction is, first of all, that evolution is a multi-phase process, dynamical process, and that it, as he mentioned in his introduction, that it's not only a yes or no, but it can be yes or yes, yes and no idea. And the second thing is that it's a double-edged sword. And of course, if we consider phantom percepts as plasticity, then we can also consider it as maladaptive plasticity. So not every evolutionary aspect or changing brain might be beneficial. So there, well, you all know there is some facts about the brain that in general, men seem to have more brain than women, even though the IQ is the same for men and women, so which already means that the amount of cells itself is not very important, but probably the connections in between the cells and thus the networks that are formed in the brain are very important. Also know that we lose a lot of neurons every single day, and so this loss has to be compensated probably by developing more connections, and which suggests that the connections are not hardwired, that are changing constantly. For those who are not from the biological field, a brain consists of a couple of different lobes, which can be then subdivided in different areas on, based on a chemoarchitectonic structure, and it has been considered that certain parts of the brain have certain functions, although that this is now considered partially phrenological, in the sense that there is some areas, for example, the occipital lobe, which is related more to vision, the superior temporal lobe, which is related more to the auditory system, and the anterior part of the parietal lobe, related to the sensory system. Now, this modular buildup, you can go down and basically then create a structure where you have a kind of homunculus, and it's motor and somewhat the sensory system, meaning that certain aspects of the motor system are located at a certain place. And you have the same thing for the auditory system, where, for example, the higher frequencies are located more medially and the lower frequencies more laterally, which you can then try to visualize by using fMRI or other tests. Now the question, a relatively stupid question, is why would we have a brain? Now there is an interesting story which was first told in the book Eye of the Cortex by Rodolfo Llinas, that the sea squirt, when it's still in its larval stage, just swims around, and it has a primitive nervous system. And on the moment that it decides to go and sit on a rock and not move anymore, it basically absorbs or digests its system. So it could be considered that only if you move around or if the environment is changing quite a bit, that you need a nervous system, and that the change has to be, can be of course uncertain, but it should be predictable. A completely random environment would not be beneficial for developing a brain, as the brain could not be predictable. So from that simple point of view, brains can be considered prediction machines that basically use information from previous experiences to predict future events. Ultimately, I think this is to reduce uncertainty coming from the changing environment, and that's important for survival. So if you encounter this, that should tell you something of going back to swim in the same area the next time. So the brain has to be processing information, and most of you know this a lot better than I do, that information consists of the content of information and a certain amount of redundancy, which you also see in the brain. Now, the content of the information basically means the amount of uncertainty that's around that you can reduce. And redundancy is what we already know, what we know, and this can be considered a protection against errors. And so, for example, if you read this short line, if you leave out one or two letters, you won't understand anything anymore of what it means. Whereas if you read the full sentence, you can leave out a couple of letters and still understand what's happening. And in the brain, you see the same thing. For example, our arousal system, which goes from the posterior palms to the mesencephalon and then to the internal nuclei, is developed bilaterally, so that if you take out by stroke or hemorrhage or whatever, one side, you will be comatose for about a couple of days, but then basically the redundant part, the second part will take over and you will come back out of consciousness. So if this information is important in order to reduce the uncertainty from the environment, then it has to be transmitted, and it's considered that it's transmitted by trains of action potentials. And some theoretical work has furthermore suggested that the higher the firing rate, the more information can be transmitted. Similarly, the quicker I talk, the more information I can convey in the same period of time, up to a certain moment when it plateaus. And if I start talking too quickly, well, there won't be a lot of information being transmitted anymore either. So from a clinical point of view, this has been considered as well when we look at the EEG. And the assumption of the EEG is that it's a combination of different spectra occurring simultaneously, not only in the tonic firing mode, but also in burst mode, which is more like AK-47 salvo of action potentials. Now, we know that the quicker your oscillation rate, the more it is related to consciousness in general. And these oscillations have actually been preserved throughout evolution and consist from frequencies going from 0.05 hertz to about 500 hertz. And they seem to be there seems to be linear progression on a natural logarithmic scale. So these oscillations you can find in very primitive animals as well as in humans, and seem to have similar functions. For example, some practical examples, in reptiles, the main power spectrum of the EEG at the medial cortex is delta, which is clinically assumed to be the lowest frequency that we routinely use in clinical practice. And delta activity is what, in general, you see in the brainstem, but also in the reward system, which is most likely a misnomer and should maybe better be called a learning system. Whereas in more primitive mammals, the mean EEG power spectrum at the hippocampus is 4 to 7 hertz, which you still see in modern mammals such as humans as well. Although at the cortical level, the main frequency is at least alpha. If you look at it not from a phylogenetic point of view, but from an ontogenetic point of view, and you just look at the increase in the processing speed or oscillation rate at the occipital lobe ontogenetically, then you see that there is a progressive increase in oscillation rate also ontogenetically. And interestingly, when you look at it in reverse, for example, in Alzheimer, then the normal increase in processing speed seems to be reversed, where the higher frequencies seem to tend to fall out, and you get more and more processing in lower frequencies. So Paul McLean has developed this well-known model where he says, well, there's evolutionary, there's three stages to brain development, where you have a brainstem, which is a survival brain just related to processing critical information with regards to respiration and heart rate, feeding behavior, sexual behavior, and etc. But it is, most of it is just simple reflexes. Whereas on top of it, you have kind of a mantle consisting of what he calls the limbic lobe, which you could almost consider as an emotional brain. And considering emotions as nothing more than a priority mode, these emotions are just telling you well, you have to respond to this stimulus and not to another stimulus, but the stimulus is more important. And basically, conceptually, you could consider it as a kind of a dimmer function. And the modern animal developed neocortex, which can be then the predictive brain, trying to anticipate information so that you can better respond to it. From a clinical point of view, if you accept this, if you accept this model, then you can start to think of pathologies not only in anatomical constructs, but also related to oscillation rates. And so if you have a pathology, for example, related to the reward system, and if you want to try and modulate it, then you want to try and know what is the normal oscillation rate being presented in the reward system in order to be able to try and restore that. So therefore, I try to come up with a theoretical model which is constantly being changed, were based on this phylogenetic idea. So if you have a sensory stimulus that comes in, it will go to your brainstem where the information is already modulated by your different neurotransmitter systems. And there it goes to the phylogenetically oldest part of the sensory system, which is the interlaminar nucleus of the thalamus, which is also the link between the arousal system and the content of consciousness information system. This information will then go to the ventral striatum and the dorsal striatum, and then and from there you will get a reflectory motor output. Now, considering the fact that if you start moving, your heart rate and your respiration have to follow as well, it's not strange to see that from the same area you get direct connections to the hypothalamus, which is important for your autonomic output. And this motor and autonomic output then can be modulated either by cognition or emotion already, most likely in primitive species. And the central hub and the network for emotion might be the amygdala, not just for fear, but also for other emotions. And conceptually, a hub for cognition might be the hippocampus. Now, when you, if you have a certain response, both motor and autonomic, then you have to learn whether that response is good, so whether it's better than what you predicted or not, and that's where you have a reward system or a primitive learning system, which is centered initially on the nucleus accumbens, as part from the ventral striatum. Now, so this phylogenetically oldest part of MacLean's network can be anatomically located to these areas, and the brainstem itself and a large part of the hypothalamus might actually be also not only oscillating but also firing and delta firing rates. Now, this reflexive behavior would then need a dimmer in order to not just respond always in the same fashion, and therefore you develop a second layer which is predominantly centered on the cingulate cortex. So you have the anterior cingulate, subgenival, the supergenival, and the posterior part, which might be related more to the cognitive system, and the anterior cingulate more to the emotional system, whereas the subgenival, at least in primitive animals, is considered the visceral motor part of the cortex. Now, so this phylogenetic second layer, according to MacLean's model, might then just modulate whatever is happening in a more primitive state. And interestingly, at least in humans, the cingulate seems to oscillate in theta, and the generator coming predominantly from here, but also from the hippocampal area. And then, of course, you can develop other, just based on anatomical connections, other structures that then permit a controlled execution of what you want to look at. So you can then put some feedback and feed-forward conditioning in and look at even more connections, but then you get a model which is not practically applicable anymore. Because if you're going to put an electrode somewhere around here, well, this schedule is too difficult to predict anything of what's going to be modulated when you just stimulate. So from a practical point of view, we have to develop simpler ideas of how the brain works, at least to be able to use them in a clinical setting. And at this stage, we're still right here, where we think about miracles when we modulate brain function. So the question is whether an evolutionary point of view can be beneficial. And just like Professor Tsuda has mentioned, there is an analogy between the brain and nature, and already one of Haeckel's students, old Wilhelm Ruh, suggested that there might be an analogy between the brain and nature, and then Terence Deacon has written a nice paper on it as well, basically where Deacon considers a synapse as an animal or a plant, and the synapse formation analogous to animal reproduction, and competition for connections as the same as competition for resources. And so basically, survival of the fittest synapse can be analogous to the survival of the fittest animal. So as we know, the brain is made out of 100 billion neurons, more or less, containing each a huge amount of synapses, so that it cannot be hardwired, since we only have about 20 to 30,000 coding genes. So therefore, brain wiring has to be plastic and depends on the input, as has been suggested. So the maps are very important in order to develop some structure in the brain. So if it's not genetically coded for, where does the information that we all contain come from? Well, maybe because our brains are built in an evolutionary way, where growth and reproduction of axons can be considered as growth and reproduction of organisms, and that competition of connection depends on competition for resources and mates, more practically on chemotrophic factors, and that the fitness of the connection signal processing might be similar to natural selection. So neural networks will evolve spontaneously, filling in niches of information processes. Similar like species will evolve to fill in niches of the ecosystems. So this is important, because if that is correct, then in the moment that you start lacking information, whether it's due to an amputation or you lose sight or hearing, then your neural network will adapt in order to fill up this vacant area. So from a practical point of view, brains probably adapt to the body they live in with a minimum of pre-planned design, and that's very different from the way that medical doctors in general look at the brain, when they say, well, the brain controls the body and that's it. The body will adapt to what the brain does. But it might be the other way around. And this is important, because, as I mentioned, because emotional deaffrontation or any physical kind of deaffrontation will then have an influence on how you can treat it. As you know, neurons are initially overproduced in an immature stage, and then basically, when you add a supraluminary limb, for example, you will get less culling, and so you will have more neurons that remain there. And if you remove targets, you get the opposite, so you have more culling occurring. Not only at a neuronal level, but also at an axonal level, you have the same way. So initially, you have basically that almost everything is connected to almost everything, and depending on the input, you will get map reorganization, which then ultimately will create topographic maps in the brain, which are the ones I've shown before, the tonopathy and the homunculus kind structures. So if you look at it from an individual system, you have a topographic maps in the visual cortex, and in animals that have a binocular overlap of their visual fields, the information also overlaps at the thalamic level and at the cortical level. So this permits to compare input from both eyes, because at the level of the thalamus, the information from both eyes, if you have overlapping visual field, will be located adjacently, which permits then then a depth vision, and at the cortical level, you will get ocular dominance columns, which have been described by Hübel and Wiesel. Now, if you look at an animal, such as a frog, they don't have an overlapping visual field, and each retina projects to the contralateral superior colliculus, and you don't have these kind of zebra stripes. Whereas if you graft another eye in the middle of the head of the frog, then basically you will get overlapping fields, and automatically you do develop these interdigitated stripe maps, even though this has not been so. In one generation, your brain will adapt to the changed changed body structure, and this emerges spontaneously without a process of selection. So not everything has to be selection. So how can we apply this idea to medicine? Well, as I've mentioned, you've got the phenotopic map, which is located lower frequencies at the outside, higher frequencies at the inside. It starts at the level of the cochlea and goes all the way through the brainstem to the cortex. And this is not genetically coded for, but probably created by self-organization and adjust to the environment. Now, so from a practical point of view, sound comes into the ear, is split up in its different frequencies, and when you have, for example, high frequency hearing loss, you will have a change in plasticity in the auditory cortex. Now, initial studies by Kaas and Schwaber has shown that if you have a normal tonotopic map at the auditory cortex, low frequencies being encoded here, mid frequencies there, and high frequencies at this anatomical area, then if you create a high tone lesion, for example, with antibiotics, then the area that used to process the high frequencies now seems to respond to mid frequencies. And it was considered by Kaas and Schwaber that basically that the mid frequency neurons now establish connections, so get more or less axonal sprouting into the area that previously processed these mid frequencies. So this has been then used as a model for tinnitus, where if you here look at the auditory cortex of a cat, these are the lower frequencies being processed in this area, mid frequencies being processed in this area, and high frequencies over here. Now, if you create a high frequency hearing loss and you put in a needle, you present sound, then you will see that these cells become active now at mid frequencies and not high frequencies, because they don't perceive the high frequencies anymore. And in general, the tinnitus percept, which is perceived similar like phantom pain, is here in black. The tinnitus percept is filling up the gap of hearing loss, so which is the same in phantom pain. If you have a missing hand, you will have pain in the hand and not in the face or in another area. So that's a classical way of thinking, but maybe we can also think of it in another way. That it's not a kind of invasion from the mid frequencies into the high frequencies, but that the higher frequencies, because they lack information, that they will go and look for information in order to survive. This can be done by opening dormant synapses or eventually also by sprouting. So to come back to the introduction, I think the idea that it doesn't have to be yes or no, that it can be yes and no, or that there might be multiple mechanisms that might be occurring simultaneously. So from evolutionary philosophy, as I mentioned, the synapse, the cells that are deprived of information might go and look for information. So that there is not an invasion into the vacant territory, but that there is a pulling of information from where there is still information around. And there is not a lot of data, although that the last 2-3 years there is some more data, but in the auditory system it's lacking. And so you have to do with this information, where you see that if you deafferent the auditory neurons and the cricket system, and the cricket system is in their legs, then basically the, you will get sprouting to go. So if you deafferent this information, then you'll get sprouting to the area of where the information used to come from. And you also see that if you trim, for example, whiskers and mouse, then what you will see is that you basically get more new spine, so dendritic growth, which is required to pull information if you deafferent information in animals. So that you do not, so that you do not only have axonal growth, but that you can also get dendritic growth, which is largely not considered in neuroscience for a long time, because it was always considered, well, if there is a deafferentation, you will get entry into the vacant territory. Now, also ideologically, you like I mentioned, the tinted spectrum is related to what you don't hear. So your brain will basically create information for what is not coming in. Conceptually or philosophically almost, you can say that, well, if there is no information around, and remember that the information is required in order to increase your survival, then the brain will ultimately create its own information, which is still better than having no information. And this is most likely based on what is being stored before. So what is also important is that if you have this topographic map, which is the more Picasso-like representation of low frequencies, mid frequencies, high frequencies, and you then represent this this missing frequencies, for example, you present the animal with 40 decibels of sound above their hearing threshold, then what will happen is that the restructured map, reorganized map, will will be prevented, so which suggests that this this map reorganization is reversible, which is important if you want to start using it as a treatment, because this is most likely associated with a tinnitus or a phantom pain, and you want to go back to the original as close as possible. And if this is reversible, then it also means that from a clinical point of view, you can go and target this area in order to recreate the missing information directly. Also, based on functional imaging data, you can reconsider these information. So, for example, here you have a tonotopic map: low frequencies, mid frequencies, high frequencies. Low frequencies at the outside, high frequencies at the inside. And in tinnitus patients, if they perceive 6,000 hertz, you will get a change in the tonotopic map, and the tinnitus frequency is represented adjacent to where you expect it, and the larger the distance from the magnetic field to the expected magnetic field, the more intense the tinnitus is being perceived. So the more the brain seems to be reorganized, the worse the system seems to get, as a kind of unfortunately maladaptive plasticity. So as I mentioned, you have a map which becomes reorganized related to the deafferentation. So the brain adjusts to the environment, and but you can compensate this, and then you prevent this reorganization to occur. So from a clinical point of view, if you have a high frequency hearing loss, you get this map reorganization. And if we can deliver the missing information directly, electrically, to this area, then we should also be able to prevent the phantom sound or the phantom pain. So the way you can do that is you can present the patients with the tinnitus matched sound in the fMRI scan, and then just look at the areas of bulb activation, and then go and implant an electrode on this area, directly delivering the missing information to the area that has been reorganized based on this lack of input. Now, if the classical idea is correct, that there is an invasion, then you would predict that if you stimulate this, you will worsen the symptoms, because there is an invasion that might ultimately activate the area, and by stimulating it, you will worsen it. Whereas if the other idea is more predominant, meaning that the area just needs this information in order to prevent this reorganization, then supplying the missing information only at the area of the missing information, which you can demonstrate by fMRI, then you would expect the tinnitus or the phantom pain to disappear. And so here you see some practical examples where you have some bold activation related to the tinnitus sound that is being represented in the scanner, and electrodes that are implanted overlying the secondary and primary auditory cortex and what, on a post-operative CT scan. And what you can do is you can fuse these images and then see whether your electrode is lying really at the right place. And what you can see that depending on the character of the tinnitus, you can decrease the sound percept, so the phantom percept, very well if it considers a pure tone, not for one or another reason, if it's a noise-like sound. And if that concept seems to work for tinnitus, and we've now implanted about 40 patients with this technique, what you can also do is try to use the same thing for phantom pain, because the concept might be similar. And it has been suggested that these reorganization of the topographic maps is governed by similar mechanisms of synaptic plasticity. And if that is the case, then we should be able to do exactly the same thing for phantom pain. And what we've shown is that indeed, if you have phantom pain, what you can do is you can worsen the pain by allodynia, and then look in the fMRI scan where you get abnormal activation, then target this area with non-invasive transcranial magnetic stimulation in a neuronavigated way, so that you put this information in a kind of GPS system that tells you exactly where to stimulate. You can stimulate non-invasively, and if that works, you can go ahead and implant an electrode on this area of abnormal activity, which conceptually you could consider as the area that has been changed by the lack of input. And indeed, you can decrease pain scores fairly dramatically in patients that you have implanted with electrodes on the somatosensory cortex. Interestingly, if you stimulate at high intensities and high frequencies, you will worsen the pain. And if you stimulate at very low frequencies and very low intensities, as if just delivering what is needed, then you decrease the pain. So from a practical point of view, I think even if the model is wrong, thinking or applying in medicine some more evolutionary thoughts might be helpful in developing new treatments, because you could consider whether it's physical deafferentation, like an amputation or hearing loss, but you could also foresee that, for example, patients with Charles Bonnet syndrome who have visual hallucinations based on the deafferentation, or even an emotional deafferentation, that in the future you could try and apply the same mirror philosophy, if you can say, to try and deliver the missing information.